So thank you to everybody, to all of our distinguished guests for joining us today to discuss the options for foreign lobbying law in the UK. My name's Jade McGlynn. I head up the Russia and Eurasia Study Centre here at HJS, and I will be moderating the discussion today. Whilst I would like to extend a warm welcome to all of our audience, I'd also like to add a particular welcome to those joining us via the Politico London Influence email. We're delighted to have you, and if you'd like to sign up to hear more from us, there's a link to our mailing list sign up in the description below the video. Our discussion today will be examining the various options for progressing with foreign lobbying laws, which could assist us in the UK in countering the disinformation and aggressive lobbying and influence operations that hostile adversarial states undertake in London. But before we begin in earnest, I just have a tiny bit of housekeeping. So everybody should be muted, apart from the speakers. If you would like to ask a question, please type them into the Q&A function, and then later we'll select questions and invite you to unmute yourself and then ask your question to our four speakers, whom I will now introduce. So we have Bob Seeley MP. He's the Member of Parliament for the Isle of Wight and the main author of the report that we're gathered here today to discuss. We have the High Commissioner, George Brandis QC, so the Australian High Commissioner to the United Kingdom. He's also served as a minister in three Australian governments, and as Attorney General, he was responsible for the reform of Australia's espionage and foreign interference laws. Edward Lucas is a senior fellow at the Centre for European Policy Analysis, a columnist for The Times, and formerly a senior editor at The Economist. His expertise lies in intelligence and cybersecurity issues, with a long-standing focus on Central and Eastern Europe, but also expertise that encompasses China. And then we have Clive Hamilton, who is the Professor of Public Ethics at Charles Sturt University in Canberra. Professor Hamilton has published two books on China and Chinese influence in Australia and beyond, and these books have been so well received by the CCP that Professor Hamilton has unfortunately been banned from entering the country. So, with the introductions made, I'm going to start the questions with the main author of the report. So, Bob, if I could ask you, could you please explain why the UK might need anti-foreign lobbying laws? What's wrong with the UK's current lobbying act?
I think what's wrong at the current moment is that I'll try to sum it up in a minute, but the UK is an influence peddler's paradise at the moment. Hostile state activity since the 1990s has become more subtle, more complex in many ways, and more broad. And a lot of these details have been outlined very eloquently by Edward Lucas and Clive Hamilton in their works on Chinese and Russian influence in Australia and the West more generally. What we're looking at with PR, with lobbying, with financial influence, and leading up to sometimes political corruption, is elements of the old sort of KGB subversive warfare model, which nowadays could be seen to sort of fit into a wider sort of hybrid struggle model of state competition. Our own laws, I don't think, are adequate to deal with the current problem, because our lobbying laws are very weak. And as I say, you've got this combination of an increasingly complex problem and very weak laws in our own country that have a very narrow and limited definition of lobbying. And that is a bad position for us to be in.
Thank you for that helpful sort of primer on the issue and summary and sort of a summary as well of your excellent report. High Commissioner Brandis, you were instrumental in reforming, or you were responsible for reforming the foreign lobbying laws in Australia the production of the so-called FITSA. So do you think that the Australian model could be adopted here? And if so, what is there anything you would change?
Thank you. Can I begin by complimenting Bob Seeley and the Henry Jackson Society on this report? As you say, I was the Attorney General who was tasked by the then Australian Prime Minister to develop these laws. And the answer to your question is basically that the entire legislative package, which comprised basically two important pieces of law reform, what was called in Australia the Foreign Influence Transparency Scheme, which is the lobbyist register, but also an act called the Espionage and Foreign Interference Act, which creates a new criminal offence, which expands beyond the pre-existing definition of espionage, the kind of malign conduct which is criminalised, hostile state activity by or on behalf of a foreign principal. Both of those pieces of legislation were designed in consultation with the other Five Eyes nations, including, of course, the United Kingdom, though most particularly informed by the American experience of the FARA Act, the Foreign Agents Registration Act, which is a rather antique piece of legislation that goes back to the 1930s. It was prepared by me and by my department on my instructions quite advertently to be a world's best practice model from which other Five Eyes countries and other countries as well could draw. The experience, and I hope you'll ask me some questions about this a little bit later, but the experience in Australia since the legislation came into operation nearly 3 years ago now has been very encouraging. The prophylactic effect of this legislation has been very successful in dealing with the problem. So the short answer to your question is the entire Australian legislative package is adaptable by the United Kingdom.
Okay, wonderful. That's a really nice, clear answer. Thank you. Professor Hamilton, if I could turn to you, obviously you yourself have been the victim of some of China's influence campaigns. What do you think that the UK can learn about sort of Chinese sharp power and influence operations, sort of managing and countering them from the Australian experiences? So for example, if in terms of the tactics, do you feel that there's something specific in the way that perhaps China targets the sort of Australian society, or do you think that there isn't such a cultural adaptability in their approach? Professor Hamilton? Oh, you're on mute.
I think there's a very large overlap in the situation of the two nations. Australia has a couple of differences, a very large Chinese diaspora, for example, and a very strong trade and investment relationship, which makes us more vulnerable to state coercion. But the kinds of foreign interference that the Chinese Communist Party uses, it uses in Britain very much as it does in Australia, that is targeting elites in particular in order to win them over to the CCP's point of view, and in some cases coercing them through various measures. And so the kind of activities that the CCP engages in order to gain influence in other countries, I think, as the High Commissioner said, very much fall outside of existing legislation. The definition within the Espionage and Foreign Interference Act must be distinguished from the Foreign Interference Transparency Scheme. The Foreign Interference Act defined a new crime with heavy penalties, and that is acting covertly on behalf of a foreign state or a foreign principal in order to influence government decisions or interfere in a democratic exercise of a democratic right. And this covered a whole lot of activities the Chinese Communist Party was engaged in Australia. And it really was, I think, an exceptionally world-leading piece of legislative drafting. And I think the High Commissioner is probably right in talking about the prophylactic effect. Certainly, my perception is, as an expert in foreign interference, Chinese CCP interference in Australia, there does appear to be some change in the modus operandi of China in Australia.
Okay, that's really interesting. Thank you. Please forgive me for interrupting the discussion just a second. I just wanted to say that we've had some difficulties with many people joining this webinar. Perhaps certain friends in certain hostile states aren't keen on the discussion. But if you've not joined on Zoom and you've been referred to the Facebook live stream among our audience, please do submit a question there and we'll do our best to ask it for you. And of course, please, for those who are on the Zoom webinar, please do feel free to put your questions in the Q&A function. Thank you and apologies for that. So far in our discussion and our questions, we've seen some of the many benefits of having a foreign lobbying act. But if I could now turn to Edward Lucas, many of China and Russia's sort of lobbying and actions occur in, I suppose, what could be described as a grey zone. And I think we'll talk later on about how we can decide where black begins and where white ends within the grey zone. But is there a risk with implementing such laws that in fighting the CCP or Putin that we lose the very open society we're trying to defend? And how do we guard against this?
Well, thanks very much indeed, Jade, and to Henry Jackson, and congratulations to Bob and his co-authors on their excellent report, which is both timely and very insightful. I'm also very glad to see the High Commissioner again, and I just wish we'd listened to Australia a bit earlier. It's he's too polite to say so, but we should have been we're late on this one. I think that there are some risks. That doesn't mean we shouldn't do anything, but we need to be very cautious and deliberate in what we do and be aware that there will be some minuses as well as some pluses. So I am absolutely in favour of a lobbying act and of toughening our stance, and I've been arguing this for 25 years. So what I say now is really just to highlight the possible downsides. And there are really two. One is retaliation, and we just need to be aware. And I've been a foreign correspondent in Russia, and before that I was a foreign correspondent behind the Iron Curtain, and I knew that every time a Soviet correspondent or Warsaw Bloc, Warsaw Pact correspondent was caught spying in London and expelled, that I might be the target of that retaliation. So there are the BBC offices in Moscow and in Beijing. We'll be vulnerable to what we do, and so will be a range of other people. And we've seen the ruthless use of counterintelligence means by both the Russian and Chinese regimes against people like Peter Humphrey and against people in the two Michaels and other cases in Russia. So we just need to bear that in mind. This doesn't come cost-free. The other sort of deeper worry is that we don't defeat Putinism by Putinizing our own society. And there is a danger, which we see more in the countries closer to Russia, where you see everything through a counterintelligence lens. Anyone who disagrees with the government is therefore a traitor and probably working for the Kremlin, in fact, certainly working for the Kremlin, and therefore you need to hurl everything you've got at them, from the criminal justice system to the tax authorities to broadcast regulators. You throw the whole book at them. And this is bad for several reasons. It discredits us in the eyes of Russians and people around the world generally. It blurs what makes our society special, which is institutions and structures and rules. That in our society, a policeman really is a policeman, and an oil company executive really is an oil company executive, an intelligence officer is an intelligence officer, an academic is an academic, a think tank is a think tanker, a journalist is a journalist, and so on. And these are different professions, different institutions, they operate by different rules. And we need to be careful that we don't move to this Russian model where all those things are basically combined. So someone's a Gazprom executive in the morning, an organized criminal in the afternoon, an intelligence officer in the evening, and probably many more things as the day goes on. So we really need to be careful about that. I think we need to assume good faith. And it's that's a very important thing, that we take people on trust until they prove otherwise. And we also, finally, we have to accept that these are subjective criteria. This is not saying, you know, people over 6 foot can't get into the plane because they're too tall. This is going to be it's going to involve a level of judgment. And we have to be deliberate about those judgments. So, for example, I'm very much in favour of saying there is a category called hostile state. And maybe we start off putting North Korea and a few real rogue states in. And then we say, if you continue down this road, you will be a hostile state. And maybe there's different gradations like we have with terror alerts. And once you go into that category, then different rules will apply. But we have to be clear, we're making basically a subjective judgment. And we'll be able to obviously review it if different things come to light. But this isn't physics. This is English literature. It's about judgment, and we have to be clear about that. I'm really looking forward to the discussion, and I see we have 88 participants on the Zoom call, which is a fantastic turnout. And thank you to all of them for turning out, and to all the people who've joining us on Facebook.
Could I just follow up briefly on Ed's comment there?
Yes, of course. Please do.
I think it's very important to draw a distinction between the implications of the foreign interference legislation, such as Australia's, and the counter-terrorism laws that were introduced after 9/11. After 9/11, the argument of governments was, look, we're going to have to sacrifice certain rights, certain freedoms, in order to fight this enemy of terrorism. I think the foreign interference legislation is quite the opposite. What we're seeing in the part of the Chinese Communist Party is an infiltration and corruption of the democratic processes in countries like Australia and Britain through suppression of free speech, through coercion of people, through infiltration of institutions. And what the foreign interference legislation does is protect those institutions by criminalizing certain kinds of coercive and corrupt activities. So I think there's a very distinct difference between the counterterrorism laws and the foreign interference laws, which is aimed at protecting the democratic rights. For example, the right to free speech of Chinese heritage people living in Australia who are afraid of intimidation and retaliation should they participate in the political processes in Australia as citizens.
Thank you. Yeah, it's a good point. I think as well about just maintaining this distinction, which if I understand correctly, was also Edward's sort of the crux of Edward's point as well.
May I come in very briefly?
Yes, please do.
I mean, there are so many interesting things said. I'll just be very brief. I mean, I think for me is I completely agree what Clive says. You have to protect democracy. This for me is part of our foreign policy, because it's how some countries, China and Russia, choose to engage with us. So to see lobbying as entirely separate from other events throughout the world or how other states interact with us, I think would be wrong. And I think those states, some of them, see lobbying part and parcel with espionage, although we rightly see these things as significantly different. So this is what the High Commissioner says. This is absolutely part of a package of laws. You have to include espionage, you have to include lobbying, you have to understand this more flexible world in which we inhabit. But Edward's right, there is danger because you're overseeing relationships. And clearly we need to be really mindful of that in a democracy, and specifically cultural relationships. So Confucius Institutes, and specifically maybe universities. We've seen, there's a story in the Times recently saying that a lot of universities now may be in trouble because they've been accidentally helping China's arms program, which clearly they shouldn't be doing. So there is a case for overseeing those relationships, whilst at the same time having as light a touch as possible, but it has to be effective. And although we've outlined three alternatives, for me, in many ways, the best system would be one that has a two-tier approach. So this is like the Queensland Tourism Board issue. You know, how do you treat a Russian oligarch, Huawei, a China front company, and an entirely harmless Western entity that wants to do some lobbying in the UK, like the Queensland Tourism Board? So you have to, on one hand, have very low and very high trust standards and low regulatory standards with 95% of people who do business or lobby in the broadest sense of terms, the New Zealand Tourism Board, the Chicago Symphony Orchestra, whoever wants to do a bit of lobbying. But then for non-democratic states, for hostile actors, you have a very high bar. And if we don't capture Putin oligarchs and Chinese front companies, this espionage, this lobbying bill would not be doing its purpose. So it's got to capture those groups and give us as much information about them, whilst at the same time allowing, you know, the Queensland Tourism Board to do its sort of lobbying business in the UK with a very low threshold of paperwork and a high threshold of trust.
Okay, thank you. I think this is a very common sense approach. I suppose one concern might be about how to actually implement it. I mean, as has come up already quite a lot, it's not always so easy to distinguish which actors are which in sort of from the CCP in Russia. They have this kind of, I suppose, sort of like a very evil version of what we would call fusion doctrine working across the works in these countries. And in particular, I suppose I want to ask, and it'd be particularly interesting to hear from High Commissioner Brandis here on the Australian experience of where do we draw these lines? So for example, in Russia, there are very many GONGOs, government organized NGOs. And how do we decide, you know, what is the line for deciding whether or not, you know, they are organised completely, whether or not they are state actors or non-state actors. And we also have, of course, the issue of sort of lobbying by non-state actors that are funded by nation states as well. So is that something that's covered by the Australian legislation, and how has that worked in practice?
Well, yes, it is covered by the Australian legislation. And may I say, I agree with everything that that Edward Lucas and Bob Seeley and Clive Hamilton had just said. I mean, this is one has to be very careful in protecting a liberal society, not to draw these laws too sweepingly. It's also important, and this is a point I think that arises from what Bob was just saying, that the ordinary intelligence functions of domestic intelligence functions of the state in this country of MI5 will continue to go on. I mean, it's not as if the existing apparatus of protection against espionage and malign conduct by hostile state actors and their agents will not continue to be pursued. But what the Australian model does is add an overarching legal apparatus to augment, not to replace, the existing intelligence function. Now, in relation to the question of how you distinguish different categories of foreign influence, the Act, actually, the Foreign Interference Transparency Scheme, gives a definition of acting on behalf of a foreign principal. And it also defines the nature of the activity. It has to be an activity engaged in seeking to influence a political or a governmental decision, for example. So so at each point in the process, that you have to identify that there is a foreign principal. You have to characterize the conduct, so that not all conduct is caught, but only conduct of what is broadly a political character or conduct designed to influence a political outcome like an election, or influence a governmental outcome like, for example, the making of a decision by an agency or a civil service decision maker. So all of these, we've tried in the Australian model to capture those necessary limitations while still drawing the legislation sufficiently broadly that it captures malign conduct.
Jade, High Commissioner, may I just come in very briefly? That, I mean, you make a fascinating point about where the boundaries are, and everyone here has a good idea of where they think it should be. But in the City of London, for example, we have a specific problem of oligarchs and certain individuals wanting to make sure that London is safe for large flows of questionable money that Edward Lucas and other folks like him have highlighted have come out of the Russian Federation and former Soviet states. And those same people who may be aligned to the Russian regime are also engaged in the business of lobbying politically as well. So how wide is one trying to capture this? And is one trying to expose a covert and malign influence in economic and financial spheres as well? Or are we narrowly defining in terms of policy and politicians? And this is one of the questions that I'm not quite sure we're ever going to come up with a suitable answer to. Thank you.
Well, Bob, I think you in the United Kingdom, because the City of London is such an important centre of global capital and transactions, that you have a more acute problem in that context than we have in Australia. The Australian legislation was designed primarily with political and governmental influence in mind. Not to say that other forms of financial malpractice, which might be in part of a network of conduct, which also includes lobbying, isn't caught by other laws, by other commercial laws. But the Foreign Influence Transparency Scheme legislation in Australia and the foreign interference legislation is first and foremost about seeking to influence political, governmental, and electoral outcomes.
Thank you for that clarification. Actually, we've had a question from an audience member from Latika Book of the Sydney Morning Herald, and I think it I'm going to ask you a little bit earlier, because I think it chimes in so well with where we are in the discussion. So Latika asks, Australia has paid a price for its stance on foreign interference with China retaliating. Is there a danger Britain will fear economic retaliation as well, and therefore defer any moves to crack down on foreign interference?
Well, yes, there is a danger. And Beijing, I note, has been ramping up its campaign of threats in public, and I'm sure even more arm twisting in private, in order to deter the British government from introducing legislation such as Australia has. But this is really a decision, I think, for the British people. And it comes down to how much is our sovereignty worth? How much are we willing to risk in terms of our, you know, let's be concrete, our future economic growth rate, in order to maintain our status as a sovereign nation? And, you know, in the recent context, obviously, within certain parts of Britain, there's a very powerful sense of winning back and maintaining sovereignty. And of course, politicians such as Bob Seeley here are strongly motivated by a desire not to have Britain unduly influenced, particularly through covert and coercive measures, by a powerful authoritarian state. So I think that's a debate that has to be had, which we had in Australia. And we saw the, firstly, Prime Minister Turnbull, and then Prime Minister Morrison, particularly in the last 6 to 12 months, draw a line in the sand and say, look, these are matters of national sovereignty, these are our democratic institutions, and we want to communicate to you in Beijing in a calm but firm way that we are not going to sacrifice them. And unless a nation does that, it's lost.
Thank you for that clarification. Are there any other members of the panel who would like to? Edward, please.
Yes, I think there are two things that the Chinese Communist Party and the Kremlin both count on. One is that we will flinch at the thought of taking economic pain. And the other is that if they inflict economic pain, they'll be able to inflict it on one country alone. And to both of those, we have answers. One, for a start, we can say, yes, we don't put our economic welfare ahead of everything else. And if we have to take some lumps, we'll take them. And by making it quite clear that we're willing to do that, it makes it less likely that they try and inflict those that pain on us. The second point, and there are examples of countries, you know, the Baltic states, for example, Poland and others, who've quite happily taken economic hits from on Ukraine, another example, they've taken economic hits from Russia, for example, on energy supplies, because they just prize their national sovereignty more. And the lesson is that the tougher you are and the more resolute, the less likely you are to get hit. And the other point is solidarity, that if, say, the Chinese Communist Party tries to punish Australia by by restricting wine imports, well, we could have a Five Eyes or D10 or, you know, OECD, you know, Global West response, where we say, right, we're all going to drop tariffs on Australian wine and try and take up the slack. And I actually launched a campaign called Freedom Wine to encourage people to drink Australian wine. I was pleased to see that over lockdown, consumption of Australian wine in Britain has rocketed. We had Freedom Cheese when the Lithuanian dairy industry was being hit by sanctions from Russia, and we got lots of people to buy cheese. So we can do stuff. We have agency in this. And if the our adversaries see that when you pick on country X, lots of other countries keep in and try and blunt the pain, and country X says, we don't care, we can do what we want, then that double whammy in reverse, you know, back at the adversary, makes it much less likely that they're going to try this tactic in the first place.
Thank you. I don't drink, but I followed your Freedom Wine Twitter campaign with enthusiasm. Bob, would you like to come in?
Just very quickly add, I mean, there is a depressing attitude in this country amongst some, including sadly in government, who equate high ethical standards with increased cost. And if anything, there is that we know that there is a cost to having low ethical standards as well, which is the damage to the reputation to the city and to the questionable financial flows which corrupt the London markets and corrupt individuals. So high ethical standards, as long as it's, you know, intelligent and commonsensical based, actually is part of an overall quality which pays in the long term. the Foreign Affairs Committee held evidence yesterday about forced and slave labour. And one of the conclusions that we were coming to is that by aligning with other countries, be it Scandinavia, Australia, the United States, European Union, we can drive up ethical standards and push slave labour and forced labour to the fringes much more than is the case at the moment. And I do think in relation to Australia, I've been drinking a lot of Australian red wine. I try to avoid French and most things Chinese. I do think we need to be much readier to support allies, because the Australians have been pretty good allies to us over the years. And I think they have clearly taken a very impressive stance in relation to China. And I do think that we should be supporting that stance more, not in an aggressive picking an argument kind of way, but in the way that Edward has outlined, where you quietly confirm your values, that you're not willing to trade them for an extra half percentage point of your GDP, because you know that will come at a greater cost in terms of values, politics and economics at a later date. So international solidarity is important, but also reaffirming our values. One of the things that the Russians are very sure of when they talk about their own value system, they equate the West with a sort of decadent amorality. And actually, I think it's really worth pushing back on that and stressing that our values are actually critical to our success in whatever, however you define that, political or economic.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah, I think, of course, it's a point, as you spoke about, that touches on many issues, this idea of sort of walking the walk, as it were, and not just talking the talk, and being prepared to take some financial pain in recompense for your values. I think at this point, I would like to just return slightly to the report, because I think it links in here. We've been discussing some of the possible reasons why the UK government may find it hard or may be tempted not to implement foreign lobbying laws. In your report, Bob, you provided several options, sort of an easy, a moderate and a hard. What are the risks if the government does just sort of go for the easy option?
The risk, simply put, is that it won't work. I mean, we've had a slight frustration, for example, with the security investment bill, which has just gone through. And it's great. There's lots of really good things in the bill, and government's brought it in. It's been right to bring it in. But the question about national security, A, there's no definition of national security, and B, the only person who makes a decision about whether something is in potential breach of national security is the Secretary of State for BEIS, the Business Secretary of State. So we're looking at it in terms of very narrow terms of trade. And again, I think we're slightly missing a trick here, that we need to think about things more broadly, because we see the way that potentially adversarial states behave in relation to us. And I think treating things in a very narrow departmental way probably is not the way ahead. So, to answer your question, if we go for the easy option, actually, the bill won't achieve what it needs to achieve and the law won't achieve what it needs to achieve. And I'm sure Edward's going to come in a second. What we need is a system that allows, you know, lobbying from sort of democratic states to carry on in a transparent and overt way, but at the same time, capture those people or organisations that may have malign intent or be working potentially for adversarial states. So any law that doesn't catch oligarchs and doesn't catch Chinese front companies will not have succeeded in its aims, to put it crudely. Thank you.
Edward, would you like to come in?
Yes, so I absolutely agree with Bob, and I apologise to anyone who is hoping to have a vigorous disagreement on this panel, because I think we're not going to have one. But I do think there's a weakness here, that we don't look at this hostile state activity in the round. We tend to think there's a thing called disinformation, so that's DCMS. There's a thing called foreign espionage, so that's the security service. There's a thing called dirty money, so that's FCA or Bank of England. There's a thing called hostile state foreign investment, that's BEIS. And this is ridiculous. We are being these are threats that have lots of different vectors, and that we need something in government that really pulls the threads together. We have a Russia unit, which is great, but that looks outwards at Russian activity broadly outside this country rather than in. We have a thing which is sort of part of MI5 called JSTAT, which is supposed to be the task force on hostile state activity, but it doesn't really do dirty money or disinformation. So I think we need to have go back to the old idea we had during the many years ago. There was something called the Committee for Imperial Defence, which will pull together everything from business and telecommunications and shipping and all these different things, right through to military and espionage. And it sat in the heart of Whitehall and had a grip on the whole thing. And don't have that at the moment, and that I think is the biggest weakness. We actually have quite a lot of tools if we want. We can tackle things through visas, for example. If there's some, we don't need a new law to say to some, we don't like what you're up to. Your visa's not being renewed. If some, plenty of means available. What we're really lacking, I think, is not a bigger toolbox, but the willingness to use the toolbox in a systematic and coherent way.
Can I add to what Edward Lucas has said, please, and with which I agree? It's important to emphasise that the Australian legislation was not about reinventing the wheel. It wasn't about criminalising or regulating in a new form conduct that was already criminal. What it was about was identifying a species of conduct that had hitherto in Australia and still in the United Kingdom escapes the reach of the law. And that is why we speak about influence. Now, influence, particularly influence directed to influencing political and governmental outcomes, is a very amorphous concept. But the fact that it's amorphous doesn't mean that it can't be malign if engaged in by a foreign actor or on behalf of a foreign principal for a malign purpose. And that's why I said in my opening remarks that we found in Australia that this blithe assumption that it would all be captured by the old common law of espionage was quite wrong, that there was a whole hinterland of malign influence on behalf of foreign states and foreign actors, directed to our democratic and governmental and electoral processes that weren't being caught by any law, which ought to be. And that is why this was a two-part operation, a piece of law reform, both criminalising malign influence not already caught by the law of espionage or the other areas of the criminal law, and also requiring transparency by registration of influence on behalf of foreign actors that wasn't malign, but nevertheless, it was in the public interest, ought to be disclosed. So the fact that influence was sought to be exercised, not for a malign purpose necessarily, but on behalf of a foreign actor or principal, was something that the public ought legitimately to know.
Could I just add to that? I mean, I think the point George makes is exceptionally important. This is a new kind of activity that we've been confronted with, and we've had to understand what's happening in the first instance. And most countries haven't begun to understand what's happening. Fortunately, the UK is now having that discussion. But there's a more difficult form of influence that operates in Australia and elsewhere, and that is this legislation cannot get at, and that is the way in which Beijing, the Chinese Communist Party, and its various agencies mobilise proxies within Australia, Australians, to really act on its behalf. The wine industry was mentioned. When bans were put on the Australian wine exports, the executives of the wine industry began jumping up and down and saying, the government, you must fix the relationship. In other words, they were transferring responsibility for the problem onto Australia. It's all our fault. We're mismanaging the relationship somehow. And so fix it, and then we'll be able to get back to normal. And it's very important to understand that mobilising domestic actors to serve as megaphones for Beijing's message is exactly a CCP strategy. It uses this strategy constantly around the world. And so, I mean, in this country, some of the most powerful de facto or in effect spokespersons for the interests of the party in Australia are mining magnates and vice chancellors. And in this case, legislation can't, they're participating in the democratic process. They're protecting their financial interest, the industry, and they're entitled to do that. And so what is needed in for this is a civil society response. It needs to be called out. It needs to be pointed out that what they're doing is actually Beijing's dirty work. when they're blaming Australia for it and saying that we should sacrifice our principles by, for example, watering down the foreign interference legislation or allowing Huawei into our 5G network. And so they need to be called out for attempting to persuade Australia, the Australian government and the Australian people that wine exports, and let's face it, I mean, these wine companies have been making shed loads of money over the last 10 or 15 years, and they want to keep it. So they need to be called out for effectively what is unpatriotic activity.
Thank you. So if I've understood correctly, this isn't just about legislating, but it's also about, isn't just about legislating in the sense of criminalizing, but it's also about creating more transparency and perhaps also a social stigma around some of the sort of domestic actors.
Absolutely fundamental. The public debate and the media, this battle cannot be won without the media, without light being shed on the activities of the CCP and Putin's Russia. So that the public understands, when the legislation was introduced, and correct me if you think I'm wrong on this, George, the Australian public, this was at the end of 2017, I don't think the Australian public had any idea what was going on, why it was necessary, what it would do. And it was up to civil society actors and the media to explain what was happening, what the CCP was up to in Australia in very concrete ways. No good talking in abstractions. You have to talk about what they're doing, where, who's doing it, and what the effect is. And that's when the public starts to understand and back these new kinds of measures.
Well, Clive, that's true. I should say that the legislation is, of course, country agnostic. But that having been said, I think Australians were very well schooled about certain ill-intentioned, significant adversaries by a discussion that had been a very lively discussion in the media. A lot of that discussion, frankly, was led by you, that your book, Silent Invasion, I think the publication of that book was a real turning point in the public, both the public awareness and public attitudes to this issue. And that sort of laid that made my task of advocacy, I might say, a lot easier than it might otherwise have been.
Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you. So I think on this note, very pleasant note, we should go to some of the audience questions. So the first three questions I'm going to ask are from Ewan Grant, from Gila Rose, and then from Noel Haji Michael. So if we could start with Ewan, please. Ewan Grant.
Yeah, thank you very much, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Yes, indeed. My question is, the High Commissioner mentioned the fact that the legislation was designed in consultation with and could be adapted and used by Five Eyes countries and indeed beyond. Which countries are showing interest in that? Because they certainly should be, and which not? Particularly in the case of the European countries, where I think there are some real grounds for concern, I'm speaking from personal experience, and how ready is the West generally for a problem that Australia and Canada have had, noticeably, interestingly, not yet the United States, about hostage taking, particularly by China, maybe by Russia. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Grant. If we'll just take the second question, then we'll come back and the panel can answer afterwards. So if we could take the second question from Gila Rose, I hope I'm pronouncing your name correctly.
Yes, good morning. What I want to know is if there is a concerted character assassination by a foreign power, how can we legislate for something like that?
Thank you. And then the third question we'll take from Noel Haji Michael, please. Noel?
Thank you very much. Can you hear me?
Thank you.
My question as a London-based Australian is one difficulty the presence of a large and well-integrated diaspora in countries like Australia, Canada, and the UK, that citizens often third or fourth generation are still targets of intimidation and coercion?
Thank you. Thank you for your question. Okay, so if we start with you and Grant's question, is there anybody on the panel who'd like to tackle that one? Edward, please.
Yes, I'd like to answer Ewan's and also Gila's together, because I think there are countries in Europe that are really good at this, but they keep their light a bit under the bushel. Finland has an idea of comprehensive defence, which integrates everything from the energy system through to the media, infrastructure, the whole thing. And they have regular exercises, they have training courses where managers in all sorts of different bits of the economy go on 3 or 4 week intensive training courses about security threats and how to deal with them. And it works really well. And other countries in the region are now scrambling to rebuild the similar systems that they had during the Cold War, so Sweden particularly. And with regard to character assassination, one of the spurs to Finland to really fine-tune their system was the attack on a Finnish journalist, Jessica Aro, who was the first Western journalist to investigate the Internet Research Agency in St. Petersburg, the Troll Factory. And she got the most extraordinary amount of abuse online and offline as well. And this really sort of shamed the Finnish system when they realized that a Finnish system could be intimidated this way and actually had to leave Finland and go abroad. And so they've now set up a thing called soft target protection, which means that journalists, academics, think tankers, campaigners, anyone who's in this sort of space where they can be attacked by a hostile foreign power, which in Finland's case is almost only Russia, gets a tremendous amount of protection, ranging from psychological and legal support through to a hot button, so they don't have to just go down to the local police station and say someone's out to get me. They get a proper case officer. And it works very well. And since they've done that, I think Finland is probably the last country in the Nordic Baltic region that will be attacked, although it's not in NATO and a lot smaller than Sweden, because they've got their defences lined up. We could also learn from the Czech Republic, I think, which has a Centre for Countering Hybrid Threats, which does a pretty good job. So there's lots out there, but we need to get off our high horse in Britain and be a bit more willing to learn from countries that have been dealing with this for longer and more deeply than we have.
Can I have a go at Noel Hedger-Michael's question, please?
Of course.
Who asks about how legislation like this can effectively operate in a country like Australia with a large integrated diaspora. And Australia, of course, is a very proudly multicultural nation, very successful multicultural nation. And there are lots of, for example, Chinese citizens who are hugely valued Australians, and the Chinese community are great contributors to Australia's sense of what being a modern multicultural nation is. The point of the Australian legislation is that it operates on the principle of agency. Agency on behalf of a foreign principle. And there's in fact a definition of what constitutes acting on behalf of a foreign principle. So if a person, an Australian citizen or otherwise, undertakes a defined activity under an arrangement with the foreign principle, in the service of the foreign principle, on the order or at the request of the foreign principle, or under the direction of the foreign principle, then they attract the operation of the act. And then the activity has to be of a defined kind. But it's important to remember that the key link here that the legislation attacks is agency on behalf of a foreign principle by someone, whether a citizen or a non-citizen, within Australia.
Thank you for that important clarification. Bob or Professor Hamilton, if you'd like to answer any questions, that's fine, but please can I ask you to keep it short and sweet so we have time for another couple of questions?
Yes, yeah, sorry, does Clive want to go first?
Yes, I'll try and be short and sweet. Two things. My work on CCP influence in Australia would have been impossible without assistance from members of the Chinese diaspora. But on the other hand, the party, Chinese Communist Party, targets the Chinese diaspora and mobilises them to carry out influence and other kinds of operations in Australia through the United Front Work Department and its vast network of agencies. So it's a very complex situation because, of course, like all diasporas, you know, there's a tremendous amount of political, social, ethnic, linguistic, cultural diversity within the Chinese diaspora in Australia. Just one point on the character assassination. Many of us are very concerned about the case of Professor Anne-Marie Brady in New Zealand, who has been carrying out a program of exposing CCP influence in New Zealand virtually alone. I mean, I'm blessed with all kinds of supporters and other people who do similar work. Anne-Marie Brady is virtually alone in New Zealand, and talk about massive personal pressure from burglaries of her office and her home, from intimidation, and now her university, the University of Canterbury, is under pressure from people perhaps with links to the CCP, carrying out an inquiry into her activities with a view to firing her from the university. So you can't legislate against that, I don't believe. The university, I'm sure, will stick to the law. But she deserves enormous support from all people who value free speech and democratic institutions.
Thank you. Bob, if you want to very quickly make your point.
Absolutely. I mean, the problem with what's happening with Anne-Marie is a good example of why we need to get these laws in place. A, because there are some new laws for espionage and lobbying for the benign aspects of it, but also because, as both the High Commissioner and Edward says, you have an understanding and an explaining process that goes with that, which provides an inoculating effect. So people understand. So society begins to understand these pressures. When it comes to diasporas, they're a source of strength. I mean, yes, there are risks because the Chinese can target, the Russians can target, but actually one of the best things this government has done is open the door to Hong Kongers, and I think they would be a unique additional, wonderful addition to our country. Edward is completely right. A lot of other countries are better at this and we need to learn from them. Sweden, good. Finland, the Czechs, also the Baltic republics do a lot of things very well as well. As the High Commissioner says, agency is key, but it's about identifying illegal proxies, but not always. I'll give you a very brief example. BT, the relationship between Huawei and BT, bizarre, because effectively BT, decent company, high values, became an agent almost accidentally for the Communist Party's agenda, for the Chinese Communist Party's agenda in this country, because of Huawei's influence over BT. And I think that was an accidental, if you like, an accidentally corrupting relationship for BT. And the question is, how do you stop people getting into this relationship where they're effectively becoming proxies for other people's politics?
Thank you all for your answers and for your concision. I'm just going to take two final questions. So I would like these to be from Alex Gilmore and Anton Moiseyenko. Okay, then I will read Alex Gilmore's question. One second. So following High Commissioner Brandis's comments, what additional provisions would prospective UK legislation need to make to effectively target British nationals who are agents of foreign actors rather than the foreign actor only? So what provisions do you think might be necessary?
Well, do you want me to answer that now?
Yes, I think in this case, because I've just had to read it out.
the answer is to adopt the Australian model. I mean, that's what we do. I mean, it is that the Australian model is directed to criminalising inappropriate conduct within Australia, whether by Australian citizens or by non-citizens within Australia. But the offence is committed when a person engages in certain conduct for certain purposes, covertly on behalf of a foreign principal. So the model is there to address that issue in the Australian legislation. That's the whole basis on which it works.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the answer.
Jay, just on that point, very briefly, if we were wise, the High Commissioner is exactly right. We would take the Australian model and then work out how we make it a little bit more specific to the UK, especially when it comes to looking at university relationships and intellectual property, which is clearly a big issue at the moment, but also financial flows and financial relationships as well, because these influences can be covert, malign, and potentially corrupting and potentially illegal as well.
Thank you. I'm just going to take Anton Mosienko's question, and then if anybody else also wants to refer to Alex Gilmore's question in their answers, they can. So Anton, are you there?
Yes, I am. Thank you. I feel that my question has been largely addressed in the discussion. It was about the institutional reform that would be necessary to effectively enforce any laws that are adopted. So maybe I will just use that as a chance to give the panelists another opportunity to provide any last thoughts or comments on the institutional aspects of things and sort of what has to be done on that front. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'd like to comment on that if I might, because it's a very, very important point that I think not too many people foresaw, although it's quite possible that the High Commissioner did. And that is that it's one thing to introduce legislation specifying a new crime, foreign interference in this case. It's quite another to get the intelligence and law enforcement agencies understanding what their new tasks are, particularly the law enforcement agency, because no one in the state or the Australian Federal Police really took responsibility for investigating potential crimes under the new Act and prosecuting people. And it was only when the government about 18 months ago 16 months ago, allocated $89 million in order to basically resource the Australian Federal Police and the other agencies to have people whose job is to investigate foreign interference, that we began to see some results, that is, some prosecutions from some raids and so on. So it's no good having the legislation unless the intelligence and law enforcement bodies are at the same time primed to understand what their new duties will be.
Well, Clive, you're right. I agree with that. But, I mean, Australia has now done that. In December 2019, Scott Morrison announced the creation of the Counter Foreign Interference Task Force, which might be what you have in mind, led by ASIO, which is the Australian equivalent, of course, of MI5, working with the Australian Federal Police and other agencies as well. And I am told, I know, that it has had significant success. So, you know, you need the legislative underpinnings or foundations, but then you also need the institutional resourcing to operationalize the laws.
It won't just happen. The government needs to operate, as you say, operationalize it. Otherwise, it will just drift.
Yeah, this is an important point. And I wonder if we could have Edward, and then the final word can go to Bob as the author of the report. Please, Edward.
Yes, I think it's very important. There's a tension here between the natural desire for secrecy when one comes to statecraft and the need to make a public impact. And I think that we need to be a bit better at thinking about the public side of it. So although it shows our hand a bit if we break up an influence network, maybe someone from the Chinese embassy is sent back home, maybe someone else has a visa denied and so on, I think we've gone too far on the side of trying to keep this secret. I think it's better to make the public feel that something's going on. And Estonia has been really good on this with regard to Russian espionage. Whenever they catch a Russian spy, they always prosecute, even if it's super embarrassing. And they always PNG, persona non grata, anyone from the embassy who's been involved. And I think that's better than what most other countries do, which is to say, let's not make a fuss. The Russians know what we've done, so let's just keep it quiet. Because in the end, if the other side knows what you've done, then there's no point in keeping that secret. It isn't really a secret to keep. You're keeping stuff secret from your own population. So I would urge all this, whether it's anti-money laundering, counter-espionage, criminal prosecutions, visas, whatever lever of power we're using against this, let's make it robustly public, both as a deterrent and as a spine stiffener for our own public and our own decision makers.
Thank you. Thank you, Edward. And then Bob, last word to you.
Thanks, Jade. I think transparency is critical, as Edward says. In Estonia, their secret agency report is great annual reading, and I thoroughly recommend the reports that they put out. Thank you to all the panellists. It's clear we need additional laws, but actually we also need a sense of understanding, and we need to work out how to take a holistic approach to these problems, because they are as foreign affairs, they're important domestically as they are in terms of foreign affairs. I think the Counter Foreign Intelligence Interference Task Force, yet another really good idea. The United States had the Active Measures Task Force back in the 80s and 90s. We should be looking at something very similar here. We are not there yet in our joined up governmental approach to authoritarian states and the covert and malign lobbying they do. And the FOLO document that we published today is a contribution to that debate. So thank you to all the panelists, and thank you to you, Jade, and thank you to everyone who's been listening. Much appreciated. Thanks.
Thank you, Bob. And just to echo his comments, thank you to all of our wonderful speakers for a really fascinating and enlightening discussion. And thank you to our audience as well. I'm sorry for taking you 2 minutes past the hour, and I hope I haven't inconvenienced anybody too much. But thank you once again, and goodbye.
Thank you.